this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. I am Janice Durr, Associate Minister of True Vine Baptist Church, located 124 Vine Drive in Brandon, Mississippi, where we are the ever-changing church with a global vision. On behalf of our pastor, Reverend Stanley James, I want to welcome you to our virtual online service. It is our prayer that the worship and that the Word of God will indeed bless you. But join in now with our praise team and let's lift up the name of the Lord through song. And we'll be right back with the Word. So get your Bibles as we prepare our hearts and our minds to worship our God.
It's good to know that we serve a God who continues to make a way.
Yes.
He continues to open doors. He continues to provide everything that we need.
Yes, he does.
Can somebody just lift your hands and thank God
yes.
for
thank you,
making
Lord.
A way?
Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Yes, God.
Standing here, not knowing how we'll get through this test. Holding on to faith you know best. And nothing can catch you by surprise. You've got this figured out. You're watching us now. But when it looks as if we can't win, you wrap us in your arms and step in. And everything we need you supply. 'Cause you've got this in control. And now we know that you made a way. When our backs were against the wall and it looked as if it was over, you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
Now we're here. We're looking back on where we've come from. Good that we've done,
hallelujah,
to deserve the love and mercy you've shown. But your grace was strong enough to pick us up, and you made a way. When our backs were
against the wall and it looked as if it was over,
We're standing
here
only because
you made a way.
When our backs were
against the wall
and it looked
as if it was over,
you made a way.
And we're standing here only because you made a way.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah.
Listen, 'cause you move mountains.
Yeah.
You cause walls to fall with your power. Thank you, Jesus. You perform miracles.
Yeah.
There is nothing
that's
impossible. And we're standing here only because you made a way.
You move mountains.
And
you cause walls to fall. With your power. Perform miracles.
There is nothing.
That's impossible. And we're standing here only because you made a way. You move mountains.
You move mountains.
You cause walls. because you made a way and we're standing here. Only because you made a way.
Yes, God, you made a way. Just sing that with us. You made a way, yeah.
Made a way.
Over and over again, you made a way.
So
don't know how,
but you did it.
Made a way.
Don't know how, but you did it,
Lord.
Made a way.
Thank you, Lord. Yes. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Good morning. Good morning, True Vine and friends. We are happy to be here this morning to say we have spent the month of June in Vacation Bible School. It has come to an end, and now we need to say thank you. First of all, we'd like to thank our pastor for supporting us in this endeavor. We want to thank our True Vine family, all of you that participated. Thank you to the communications team. Thanks everyone who made this possible. This is all new to us, but I think we are figuring out how to make it happen. And we are grateful. We are grateful for all of those who have made this possible. Sister Deanna, Sister Vivian Taylor, and myself, we were your directors for Vacation Bible School. And we have just been excited about those who have participated. And again, this is just a thank you to our kids and to parents. Parents, we know kids could not have done this without you. So we don't want to forget to give you a big thank you. So now I'm going, and Sister Vivian is not with us, but we want to let you know that she has been a great part of this also. So now I'm going to turn this over to Sister Deanna, and she's going to take it from here.
Thank you, Sister Ann. Good morning to all of you. As Ms. Ann said, we are your VBS directors for 2020, along with Ms. Vivian Taylor in her absence. We do thank our pastor, all of the parents, the youth, and everyone for logging on to www.truevine.org. This was something different for us, but we appreciate all of the patience, and we are so happy that you all joined in with us so that we were not able to go without Vacation Bible School this year. We had completion forms at the end of each week. We had 5 weeks of Vacation Bible School. So we thank all of you who completed those lessons and completed your forms. So this year's winner for True Vine Virtual Vacation Bible School 2020 is Raven Johnson. Let's give her a hand. She did exceptionally well along with the other students and the other youth. This is her Vacation Bible School pack. She's going to get everything that's in there. There's a lot of treasures and a lot of happies. So thank you all so much. We look forward to the upcoming year, and we have a lot of things planned for the youth. So look out for Sunday school and look out for other activities that we will have. As always, if you need us, we are here for you for anything that you all have. Remember to trust God during this pandemic, and we thank you all so much. Have a blessed week.
Lord, you are good. You've been so good. Lord, you are good. You've been better than good. I can't praise you enough. I owe you my life. Can't praise you enough. Even if I tried, 'cause you've been so good. You've been,
thank you, Lord,
so good. You've been so good to me. Yes, you have.
Lord, you are good.
You've been better than
me. You've been better than you. I can't praise you enough. I owe you my life. Can't praise you enough. Even if I tried, 'cause you've been,
yes, you have,
so good
to me.
Prepare for the word. Let us pray. God, we just come to you now as humble as we know how, Thanking you, Lord God, for this privilege and for this opportunity to come into your presence. We ask, God, that you will just anoint us afresh, that we will hear a word from heaven on today. And we'll be so careful to give your name glory, honor, and praise. For it is in the name of Jesus we do pray. Amen. Today we want to look at a very familiar passage, and that is Psalms 23. This psalm tells us who God is and what he'll do for us. For some of us, this passage is very probably one of the first Bible verses that we ever learn. Even though we may be very familiar with it, I want you to get your Bibles and follow along. I believe we're in this season that we're in, this season of a pandemic, this season that we are fighting against racism, this season of obvious injustices. I believe we're here because God wants us to stop and take a look at who he is and what he has promised to do for us. You see, God creates situations for revelations. You know, we've gotten too far from God, and he wants to create a relationship with us, a relationship of intimacy, proximity, and dependency. Sometimes God will send us right back to, or will make us sit in an uncomfortable place in order to develop us. It may not always be somebody around us or a situation around us that God is trying to fix. Sometimes he's trying to fix us. So we need to take a look at ourselves. So he puts us in a season where we have only two choices. We either seek him or we give up. And as children of God, we know we don't give up because we know in due season, God will move and we will receive a harvest. Amen. I believe God meant it when he said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and will heal the land. See, when we begin to do these things wholeheartedly, then God will heal the land. Amen. I want to talk from the subject because of who he is. I believe one songwriter put it this way. We worship you because of who you are. Now, traditionally, this Psalm 23, when it was traditionally read, it was usually at a funeral. But we miss something because we've been, as one writer says, and I quote, spiritually skiing when we should have been deep sea diving, unquote. This Psalm focuses in on what Jesus does for us all the days of our lives. The writer of this song is Jesse's youngest son, David. Y'all know David, the giant killer, the sweet singer of Israel, the man after God's own heart, the adulterer, the co-conspirator to murder, that David. He's the one who wrote this song, but now David is king of Israel. And while David wrote this song, he looks back over his life and he realizes that the Lord has brought him a mighty long way. He looks back, and when he has, from where he has come from, he realizes that the only reason he is where he is because the Lord is his shepherd. David has experience at being a shepherd. When he was with his father's house back home, he was the shepherd of his father's four-legged sheep. And now he is the shepherd of the Lord's two-legged sheep. He is king of Israel. So he looks back over his life and he realizes that had it not been for the Lord on his side, where would he be? As he looks back and he has time to think things over, he can truly say that he has been blessed and that he's got a testimony. Anybody got a testimony? David realizes that God has been good to him. And that's why he wrote this song. And this psalm is all about the Lord and his goodness. Let's take a look at it. It says, the Lord is my shepherd. He is Jehovah Roi. The Lord my provider, Jehovah Jireh. The Lord my peace, Jehovah Shalom. The Lord is my healer, Jehovah Rophi. The Lord my righteousness, Jehovah Sikkenu. The Lord who is with me, Jehovah Shammah. The Lord my banner, my protector, he is Jehovah Nissi. The Lord who sanctifies and anoints me, Jehovah Mikdash. This song is all about the Lord. The Lord, the one whose mind was his blueprint and his tongue was his tool. The Lord who spoke worlds into existence, he is Jehovah Elohim. I heard someone refer to him once as the one who put the wet in water and the dry in sand. The Lord, he is the subject of this song. Somebody say it's all about the Lord. So David says, let me testify. So he starts to testify and he says, the Lord is. Well, let's stop right there for a second. This verb is, it, as it's used here, indicates all dimensions of time. The Lord was, the Lord is, and the Lord will always be. When Moses asked the Lord, who should he tell the people sent him? The Lord replied to him and say, just tell them I am who I am. Amen. Now, even though the Lord spoke this to Moses years and years ago, what happens when we say it today? He still is who he is. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the Lord and he changes not. God is who and what we need him to be. The Lord is. The New Testament teaches us that we must first believe that he is. Hebrews 11:6 says, anyone who wants to come to him must believe that God exists and that he rewards those who sincerely seek him. So David starts out saying, the Lord is my shepherd. Even though the shepherd didn't own the sheep, he treated them as if he did own them, and he had to give an account for any that was lost. As king, the people didn't belong to David, but he was ultimately responsible if any of them were lost. What does that say to pastors today, the shepherds of God's people? The Lord is my shepherd. He is Jehovah Rohi. Then David goes on to say, I shall not want. Eastern shepherds guarded their sheep. They led them. They took care of them. They took care of them when they were sick. They rescued them when they strayed away. In every way, they simply took care of their sheep and they loved them. In the Holy Land, the pastures were lush and green following the rainy season, but the land wasn't always like that. It didn't last all year long. There were no fences out in the open wilderness. The land was rough and it was dangerous, and there were wild animals that were all around looking to hurt the sheep. A helpless flock needed constant watching. My God, what does that say to pastors, the shepherd of God's people today? Today, God's sheep, his children, are vulnerable to outside harm. So the shepherd needs to keep an eye on the sheep. Now, what this is telling us, that Jesus is sufficient for every need that we have, and as long as we're in his pasture, we shall not want. When we follow the shepherd, we have all that we need and we will not lack the necessities in this life. You see, because the Lord is my shepherd, I ain't got no business wanting, worrying, or sweating nothing. I hope my bad grammar don't offend anybody, but it's good theology, amen? David writes in Psalm 37, he says, I have been young and now am old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Let me put it another way. You see, God ain't never been taken to court for non-support, amen? God will take care of us. Paul says in Philippians 4:19, and my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. You see, when we accept the Lord as our Savior, when we're born again, we have everything that is necessary for us to walk this walk. We have access to everything that he is: peace, provision, protection, and more. That means no matter what's going on in the world, we don't have to worry. As long as we obey God's word, he's going to take care of our needs. No matter what's going on in the world, God is still our source. And when your source is okay, then you're okay too. And not only is God able to meet our needs, it gives him great pleasure to bless us and to prosper us. Know that God is always working behind the scenes on your behalf. Look for his hand of provision in your life and praise him for his faithfulness. Do whatever God tells you to do and watch him open the windows of heaven and pour out blessings that we won't have room to receive. I shall not want, because he is Jehovah Jireh. Then David goes on to say, he maketh me lie down in green pastures. Well, how come he has to make us lie down? Why does God have to make us lie down in what he has already called green pastures? Well, because most of the time, we don't realize it's green until we've gone in and come out. You know, we say, thank you, God, for my mountains. Thank you for my valleys. But notice, we don't generally say, thank you, God, when we are climbing the mountain or when we're walking through the valley. Can I get a witness to that? You know, we say, I thank him for the storms that he brought me through. Amen. I thank him because if I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that he could solve it. So he makes me lie down in green pastures because he knows what's best for us. You see, if it were up to me, I would bypass some of those problems that I come in contact with. Lord, why do I have to go through this fire? Why do I have to take on this burden? But God knows what's best for me, then he makes me lie down. He made me to lie down in green pastures that didn't seem all that green to me at the time. He made me do it so I could learn something, so he could teach me something. I didn't see it as a good thing at the time, but when I came out, I declared with Job, he knoweth the way that I take, and when he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold. You see, God's not out to get you. He just wants to make you stronger. Somebody once said, what don't kill you will make you strong. Proverbs 3:11 says, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor detest his correction. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects, just as a father the son in whom he delights. Amen. Somebody shout amen. So then David goes on and he says, he leads me beside the still waters. You see, you can't drive sheep like you do cattle. They have to hear the shepherd's voice and then they'll follow. Also, the sheep can't drink from fast flowing water. They can't drink from fast running water. The wool would become too heavy and they would be washed downstream. So the shepherd had to build a dam to kind of slow up the running water so the sheep could quench their thirst and be safe. That's peace of mind, because had the shepherd not dammed up the water, the sheep would be lost. This tells us that whatever we're going through today, it could be worse. The only reason we're making it is because the shepherd is damming up the waters. He is damming it up. He's keeping it away from us. He's holding it back. It could have been worse, but the shepherd was there. Our shepherd shields us from dangers, not only seen, but unseen. Amen. So he leads us beside still waters because he is Jehovah Shalom. He goes on to say that he restoreth my soul. Anybody besides me ever just wanted to give up? You felt like you just wanted to throw in the towel and just walk away? Anybody but me? But then the morning comes and you wake up and the Lord tells you to tie a knot in your hope and hold on a little while longer. He lets us know that he is working on our behalf even when we can't see him working. Even in the midst of our adversity, he's working on our behalf. All he asks us to do is trust him. Smokey Norfolk sang a song. He put it this way. He says, one more day, one more step. God says, I'm preparing you for myself. And he says, when you can't hear my voice, please just trust my plan. I am the Lord. I see, and yes, I understand. He restores my soul. He is Jehovah Rophi. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. You see, when the sheep stray, they get off the right path and they're headed for trouble. But thanks be to God that he's there to lead us back to the right path. Now, he doesn't lead us back because we're good sheep. He doesn't do this because we're so good. The Bible teaches that we are all like an unclean thing, and all of our righteousness are like filthy rags. So we have to be careful not to take credit when we've done something good. But for the grace of God, we would be in some other predicament. But for the grace of God, it could have been the other way. We need to recognize that when we do something good, it is the shepherd who is leading us so that he can look good, because all glory belongs to God. He wants to maintain his own good reputation as a faithful shepherd. How many of you know it's all about him? It's all about who he is. Paths of righteousness. He is Jehovah Sikkenu. Now notice in verse 4 of this psalm, there's a shift in the personal pronoun. David changes from he to you. He stops talking about God, about the shepherd, and he starts talking to the shepherd. He stops talking about God and he starts talking to God. He starts praying. Have you ever been talking to someone and telling them just how good the Lord has been and how the Lord had brought you through, telling them that how good God has been to you, and then you forget all about that they're standing there, and then you go to shout and praising God for what he's done? Has that ever happened to you? You're standing there talking to someone, and all of a sudden, here you say, Lord, I thank you. I thank you, Lord, because you've been so good. I praise your holy name. This is what David was doing here. He stopped talking about God and started praising God. So he shifts. Amen. David writes, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, he says, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, and your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You see, sheep don't like to move in darkness, and they get scared easily in new circumstances, but it is the presence of the shepherd that keeps them calm. The Bible declares that our shepherd name is Emmanuel, which means God with us. Jesus is a true shepherd who laid down his life for his sheep. And because he laid down his life for his sheep, we can come boldly to his throne of grace, and we can come into his presence where there is fullness of joy. And as we go through this life, we will have many experiences, some of which will be trying, but none of them will take the Lord by surprise. He told us in his words that in this world we would have trouble, but we are not to worry because he has overcome the world and all of the trouble. Amen. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivered them out of them all. The Lord is with me. He is Jehovah Shammah. So David goes on and he says, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Well, Lord, how come with your reputation on the line, how come you have to prepare my table in the presence of my enemies? Couldn't you prepare it in front of some folk that liked me? God said, I could, but I'm God. I'm in charge. I got this. Know that what he's doing is best for us. Now, when we think about our enemy has always been around. Think about it. When God made Adam and Eve, he warned them about the enemy that was lurking in the garden. That was Satan was around there. But yet he prepared their table in the presence of their enemy. He placed the garden right there where Satan was. All of our lives, the enemy has been there. It's always been that way. It's always been you, God, and some enemy. But in spite of your enemy, look at where the Lord has brought you. That's a good place to shout right there, because the enemy, he would have killed you if he could have. Amen. Amen. God prepares our table in the presence of our enemies. You see, God doesn't pay attention to our enemy. He's too busy preparing our table. So we need to follow suit. Don't pay attention to the enemy. I know there have been times when you've been focused on your enemy, and you've prayed something like, Lord, get them, Lord. I know somebody other than me has done this before. You know, I want to talk to some real people right about now. There have been times when you just wish that the Lord would just move your enemy out of the way. But the Bible teaches us that we are to love our enemy. Love those who persecute you. The scripture says that we have to love our enemy. It didn't say anything about the enemy loving us. Amen? Amen. And so I stand to tell you, don't focus on your enemy. Ask God to show you to your table. If we stay focused on our enemy, we won't be able to see our table, and we'll miss what it is God has prepared for us. Also, we need to remember this, that our enemy, who is being used by the devil, is also a child of God. And God's not going to be mad at somebody just because we're mad at them, amen? God is a pro at what he does, and he'll help us get through whatever the enemy throws our way. Ephesians 6 and 16 says, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. I may not always like the way God does things, but at the end of the day, I know that he will bring me through, and I'll know that it was God who did it. To God be the glory. Focus on your table. At the table is everything we need. There is joy for sorrow. There is hope for despair. There is health for sickness. There is salvation for condemnation. Everything we need is at the table. So come on and pull on up to the table. Come on over to where the feast of the Lord is going on. Amen. God is my protector and my banner. He is Jehovah Nissi. At the table, he anointeth my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. He does this so we can live in daily enjoyment of his blessing. Each day we receive a fresh anointing to carry out our daily duties. We go to the Holy Spirit for our daily consecration, and our cup runs over with an abundance of his grace, his mercy, and his love. He anoints me. He sanctifies me. He is Jehovah Mikdash. And when we're at his table, when we're moving through life, David says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. You see, God's got a double indemnity on his sheep. Not only does he lead us and take us through, but he's got some insurance for our backs. He's got two sheepdogs behind us called goodness and mercy. Amen. As an old man, David looked back over his life, and he came up with this conclusion. In spite of all his sins and all of his failures, he still had been followed by goodness and mercy. The Lord's mercy is brand new every day. He's not going to leave us helpless. Amen. And when it's all said and done, David says, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And we know this to be true because Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions, and if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. You see, under the old covenant, the sheep died for the shepherd, but thanks be to God, under the new covenant, the shepherd died for the sheep, and one day we will meet him in all his glory. Revelation 7:17 says, for the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them and lead them to living fountains of water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. That's good news. I don't know about y'all, but I'm glad about it, because one day the Lord said he's going to wipe away all tears. He's going to take away every burden. He's going to take away all sickness and sorrow. So I asked you, when he comes, will you be ready? Amen. Because of who he is, we worship him and him alone. One songwriter put it this way, the Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. I will trust in you. I will remain confident in this, that I will see the goodness of the Lord. We set our hope on you. We set our hope on your love. We set our hope on the one who is the everlasting God. You are God, the everlasting God. So as we weather this season that we're in, let us always remember who God is and what he has promised us. Amen. To God be the glory. If there is anyone listening on today that does not know the shepherd that David is talking about, I invite you to pray this prayer. Lord, I am a sinner, and I repent of all my sins. I believe that Jesus is your son and that he died and was raised from the grave. Please come into my heart and be Lord and Savior of my life. If you've prayed this prayer of salvation with true commitment and heart, you are now a follower of Jesus. Connect with a Bible-based church that will be able to lead you on your walk, in your walk with Christ. Our door here at True Vine is open. We'd invite you to join us. You may connect with us at truevine.org/connect. May God continue to bless you. Hello again, everyone. We trust that the word has blessed you. We have a couple of an announcements. The first one is we're asking all parents to encourage your children to join our youth Sunday school. This would be for ages 12 to 18. So we ask that you encourage your children to join this virtual Sunday school experience each Sunday morning. It will be an inspiring experience. Secondly, Mission Mississippi will be having its weekly prayer gathering on Thursday, July 23rd. Our pastor, Reverend Stanley James, will bring the devotional message. The prayer gathering will begin at 6:45 a.m. and conclude at 7:45 a.m. Please plan on joining through Zoom. Well, we're back. Amen. The Book of Revelation Bible study will restart on Wednesday, July 22nd at 7 p.m. Please tune in as we study what the Word of God is saying about our current world situation. This study is designed to help us as we struggle to get answers during this time in which we're living. Take a look.